Hello and welcome to the Goal Podcast, news and commentary from Gun Owners Action League, your leading voice for the Massachusetts gun owner.
I'm Garrett across, well, no, I'm not across the table. We're across cyberspace. I'm in the studio, the Goal Podcast world headquarters located in my basement. Jeff is on super secret assignment out of the Commonwealth.
Yeah, I'm across state lines. up in Portland, Maine for work. Did a flyby, stopped in at Kittery for a couple minutes on my way up, but didn't take anything home with me, so to speak.
nothing this trip, huh?
Just there were cool guns. There were guns I wanted. Like the stuff that was in my price range wasn't the stuff that I wanted, and the stuff that I wanted wasn't in my price range. You know how that goes.
You've heard it before. That's just get what you want, and that's a tomorrow Jeff problem. Right?
Yeah, well, we'll see.
Right on. Well, welcome to 2024. This is the first episode of the new year. So we got some pretty cool stuff to talk about, some news, what to watch out for in the incoming year, because we've got plenty of things to look at. So here we are. It's starting to get a little cold, starting to get just a little bit cold outside. I guess we're going to have a winter after all.
Amazing how that temperature drops immediately after the new year.
right. I think Christmas is over. I think we should just skip right ahead to spring.
Fair enough. That puts us closer to turkey season.
Yeah,
but,
it does.
On the watch list for 2024, so we're going to look for the decision in U.S. v. Rahimi.
Yep, that's upcoming.
Sometime, I don't know. Are you think that'll be out before the summer, or is that going to be another June release?
That's kind of what I think.
Something late in the session.
That's kind of what I think they're going to hang on to it till the end of the session, which will be late June. That's kind of what I'm thinking. It'll release right around the same time that Bruin did last year.
So they can all go on vacation while the entire world melts down.
Drop the bomb and then disappear. So yeah, USV Rahimi is going to drop because that was granted cert, and we had the oral arguments on that was in October, November, something like that. Also, there's a couple of petitions for cert that are still pending for this session. One of them is Range v. Garland. The other one's USV Daniels. Both of these cases are related to the federal prohibition gun possession for marijuana users. So.
Because previously it's been a federal no-no, to have a drug charge in your record like that. But recently the president came out and said that he wanted to, essentially wave the magic wand and unilaterally forgive and whatever.
Yeah, he pardoned
anybody who has a federal charge for simple possession.
And simple possession on federal charges and nothing else. So let's see. Let's tally up how many people that will help. Zero. Nobody.
Realistically, nobody.
Nobody is in federal prison for simple possession of pot.
I mean, there certainly have been people who have gone to, federal lockup over simple possession. That is true. The large part of it, though, is especially for, in Massachusetts, on the state level, the state doesn't necessarily have to recognize that.
Yeah.
And any state charges that you got along the way with that, those still stand. So I think it was a gesture that was really great on its face, but there's really nothing behind it.
Yeah. It feels to me like it's basically pandering to the base, right? I'm libertarian. I'm never going to get upset about people not being charged with, drug crimes because it's stupid, but especially something like pot. But instead of doing the actual legwork and pushing to get marijuana delisted, he's doing stuff like this, So because nobody's doing the actual hard work, that it just feels like it feels performative to me.
Yep. Very performative. I think you hit it right on the head.
What else? So a couple of non-directly 2A related things anyway. The biggest one is NRA v. Vulo. That's the First Amendment case from the NRA, which is not a Second Amendment case. We talked about it a few episodes ago. So we're going to see how that shakes out in the new year. Also, we got a couple of agency decisions coming up. The first one is the one that we talked about, the ATF redefining, quote unquote, engaged in the business, right, of selling firearms. We talked about this one a few episodes ago as well. So they are set to finalize that rule whenever they think they can get away with it. And the Department of Commerce is expected to finalize their rules, in which they basically twist and turn export control regulations in order to cut civilian firearm sales to other countries. In other words, it's just another way to try to starve the industry out of existence.
The less manufacturers there are, the less FFLs there are. You know, it's that's just the way they're taking it.
Yep. So they're trying to pinch it off using export controls. So it's, yeah, it's yet another.
And obviously, this November will play a huge impact.
Oh, yes.
And how those political headwinds are going to move. But that's not a guarantee. As we talked about before, this administration has had their bent. The previous administration did their thing. Haven't really seen what I would consider to be a pro Second Amendment president in quite a long while.
There have been
a lot of talk,
right?
A lot of talk, but not a lot of concrete substantive actions that have helped out the average everyday American gun owner.
Yeah. No real substance there. And of course, you know, echoing in the distance is Hunter Biden's own gun possession issues. And so I can guarantee those are going to be brought up during the debates. I haven't found any, like you said, I haven't found any particular candidate who's actually, the way I see it, would be pro 2A. So we'll have to see how it shakes out during the year. I don't know. But I can tell you, it ain't Biden. He's not pro 2A at all, as we can see. But
bringing it back to Massachusetts. So the state Senate, we're expecting to have their version of an omnibus gun control package, the modernization of firearms laws, however they want to phrase it. Expecting some sort of information from them sometime over the next 4 to 6 weeks. They kind of initially were looking at January. We'll see exactly how that goes.
Yep.
You know, depending on what their priority list is. The sad reality is, if there is an event that they can use to bolster their position, they certainly will.
Oh, they certainly will. Yeah. So this will be their answer to H4139, which cleared the House of Representatives, I don't know, 6 or 8 weeks ago. So the H4139 is a done deal. Senate's got to do their thing, and then they got to try to reconcile the two bills. And if they do that, then they'll send it to the governor to be signed. So we've still got some stuff to happen before any laws actually get passed here. But we are keeping a very close eye on it and seeing what the ramifications of all that are going to be. Also, the continued fallout from Bruin. I read that there's more than since Bruin dropped, what is it, about 18 months ago now, there have been more than 1,252 court challenges I think that's everywhere. I think
going after to challenge the Bruin decision itself, or court challenges against laws that have been filed in response to Bruin in those handful of states that are crappy.
I think that encompasses both their direct challenges and secondary challenges. I think it's
okay. Every, so that's, much that's including that appeals
was,
and
right. Everything that was sparked by the release of Bruin, including the tantrum laws. But so 2024 is going to be an eventful year, no doubt about that. So from our perspective, we're going to keep an eye on things and all that stuff. For Goal, obviously, we're going to get our member meeting sometime later on in the spring. Keep everybody posted on that. And we're going to keep doing what we're doing. Keep the word coming in 2024. In news, I realize I see that you're wearing a black suit and you're wearing a black suit and tie, and you've got a shawl, you know, a black shawl over your shoulders. I think you're in mourning. Are you in mourning?
Votive candles. Votive candles have been going home. In unfortunate news, Gaston Glock passed away on December 27th, a couple days after Christmas.
Age of 94?
94. He was born in July 19th, 1929.
Man, that was a while ago.
Absolutely revolutionized the firearms game, completely changed everything that we do as far as modern gun designs, going to striker fired, pushing polymer plastics as a respectable foundation for a firearm frame. But recently, just before his passing, the new Glock 49 came out. And for the people that always wondered how the hell do they come up with all these numbers and naming schemes, it's just the number design. They just go in sequential order, and this happened to be number 49. So that's why you have
next.
The Glock 45 that's chambered in 9mm and the 22 that's, I think, a 10mm. So the Glock 49, what makes this kind of unique is it was the gun that a lot of people had asked for when they started doing the hybrid models of slide lengths on different grip sizes. So this is the Glock 19 grip size, but with a Glock 17 length slide. So if you're a fan of the Glock 19, the grip's a little bit shorter, makes it a little bit easier to conceal than a full size Glock 17, but with that longer slide length, you get a little bit better ballistic performance, a little bit better projectile velocity, and a little bit longer sight radius, which they're selling an MOS version. So if you're putting a red dot on it, sight radius is kind of irrelevant anyway, but
hey, you know,
there's another variation of that new plastic gun.
Right. It's the striker fired plastic gun that was revolutionized by Glock in the 80s, right? In the late 70s and early 80s.
It's porcelain. Doesn't even show up on x-ray machines. Costs more than you make in a month.
Undetectable by your x-rays.
Which, ironically, there's some great books about the history of Glock as a company, Gaston Glock's involvement in the firearms industry.
Yeah.
And ironically enough, Glocks are overpriced. apparently, it's at one point when they looked at the pricing, they realized that if they priced it where they originally thought, they were getting fewer sales because it appeared to be too cheap of a gun.
Yeah,
so they had to up the price to convince people that it was worthwhile.
The manufacturing techniques and it's worth thinking about that. I mean, the manufacturing techniques, the part count, all of that stuff was like so revolutionary that it drove the manufacturing cost down, you know, so far that if you did like a plus percentage on the manufacturing cost, people were thinking it was still too cheap. So it was, you know.
People weren't ready to trust a $250 or $300 gun compared to, you know, what people were used to in their much more expensive revolvers and 1911s. So
you double and triple the cost and suddenly the confidence in that product goes up. Isn't that weird?
That's why we're paying $500 to $600 instead of $200 to
$300. Oh, man.
But also, Ruger.
Sturm Ruger.
60 years.
60 years of the 10/22. So it's the 60th anniversary, and in celebration of the 60th anniversary of the Ruger 10/22, they've released a new version of the collector series. It's actually the sixth edition of the collector series 10/22. It's pretty cool looking.
Which is one of those guns where I think if you don't have a 10/22 in the safe, I don't know if you can say you have a gun collection.
You ought to. Yeah. Really cool. Really cool. So that's out. What is going on? Here we go. I guess we got to get into it. Let's talk about the idiocracy. Here it comes. Gun controllers coming
under investigation. This to me is a feel-good story. I was tickled reading this story. So while New Mexico Governor Michelle Stalin Grisham continues her attempt at subverting individual liberty under a banner of what she calls a public health emergency, one of her favorite pieces of legislation, the New Mexico background check requirement, is causing a bit of trouble for the gun control crowd.
Yes, it is. Farmington, New Mexico. On December 8th, they were scheduled to do a gun buyback. You and me and Mike were chatting about this over a little text group thing. So there's a gun buyback that was scheduled in partnership with a group called New Mexicans to Prevent Gun Violence. Right, they were supposed to do it in conjunction with the city, but then the city backed out at the last minute, and this anti-gun group said, well, that's okay, we don't need them, we're going to do it anyway. When people bring their guns, we're going to give them gift cards. Except that's illegal. You can't do that if you're not, if it's not.
Yeah. So largely speaking, the sheriff's office had decided to pull out from being the law enforcement agency involved in this, partly because most people were kind of pissed, didn't want it.
Yeah.
Don't want this going on. We don't like the idea of it. It feels like it's unconstitutional. But based on some previous reporting from an AmmoLand article, David Cadrea.
Cadrea, I think, yeah.
I don't know. By David Cadrea, the police chief sort of let the cat out of the bag, and he said that his role and their role there were really to check the firearms to make sure they're not loaded. And he said because, you know, a fair number of times inadvertently – people show up and they're turning in loaded firearms because they have no idea how to handle
it. Right. Grandma gets something out of the attic and she has no idea.
You know.
Yeah, but it was eyebrow raising for him to say that, oh, really, our role here is just to check the gun and make sure that it's not loaded.
Yeah, so knowing that him and the department are creating conditions to tempt people who may not know about the safe handling and transportation of firearms.
Yeah.
Like what's the
chief loaded or not? Just
like it's endangering the people transporting the firearms. It's endangering people around them. All in all, not
sure
great.
It is. Yeah.
Police decide to pull out. So this group decides to advertise with their gun control crowd through social media and everything else that they will come door to door to handle all of this. And they're more than happy to destroy your guns for you. So that's what they did. They went door to door to people who contacted them to destroy their firearms.
Well, let's also be clear that they were taking these guns in exchange for gift cards. This was a buyback.
So they're posting about this online, and the keen-eyed folks who actually know the law were quick to point out that there were no background checks conducted for any of these transactions.
That's right. And New Mexico has universal background checks. So
universal background checks.
So they were going door to door. I think
based on all of these transactions, this group would have to register as an FFL under new guidelines.
Oh, no doubt. So they're going door to door saying, give me a gun, I'll give you a gift card, aka money. Right. And they're taking possessions of these guns and they're going away.
So the group claims that any compensation that was given to the firearms owner in the form of gift cards doesn't constitute a sale because they were given the person was given the gift card after the gun control group had destroyed the firearm.
That's
so technically crap. It didn't count. But again, they posted photos online. These firearms weren't, and I'm putting scare quotes around this, destroyed properly.
Oh no, it's like the people would take like the they'll take a shotgun and they'll cut the barrel in half, you know, and say this is destroyed and no, actually it's an NFA item now.
Yeah, you just committed way more felonies than you thought you were going to prevent.
That's a federal crime.
But the ATF, the Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms, has guidance, because of course they need to regulate everything.
Of course.
Has guidance on how to properly destroy a firearm.
Yeah, and there's things
all these rules that specifically note that you can't just run a bandsaw or a chop saw through it. It has to be a torch. It has to remove X amount of material per cut. The cuts have to be in specific locations.
Fold, spindle, and mutilate.
So by ATF standards and definitions, these guns weren't destroyed. So the transaction took place.
Yep.
These firearms weren't destroyed. So according to New Mexico statute, a sale of a firearm means the delivery or passing of ownership, possession, or control for a fee or other consideration, which includes anything of value exchanged between the parties. So,
like a gift card, for example.
They're claiming they destroyed a gun, which by ATF definitions was not destroyed. So now all of these people are still in possession of firearms.
Yep.
By the letter of the law.
Which they posted photos of online.
Anybody being investigated?
What is this? There is no transfer of firearms. We simply dismantle them.
And they're saying that it's not considered a sale. So this was the New Mexico Gun Violence Prevention co-president who said what I'm about to tell you. Said, this is Miranda Viscoli, said, we're giving them a gift card for not even close to the value of the gun, is basically a thank you for the metal and scraps.
Oh.
So now they're saying, well, it's not a sale because the value of the gift card, which I think it was $100.
Yeah.
Is so far below the actual value of the firearm that it doesn't, a reasonable person would not consider this just compensation. Now, what I would like to ask, and I would love to get this on the record from those folks, is if they plan to submit that testimony if or when a state does a mandatory buyback and offers a $100 gift card or a $200 gift card for a gun.
Yeah, that's nowhere near the value.
According to this gun control group, it's so absurd to accept that as a value.
Ridiculous. So the sheriff down there said that they've opened an investigation. I don't know if it's going to go anywhere because it's, you know, because of the politics down there. It'd be cool if it did because, by God, you know, if we tried something like that or if a gun group tried something like that and said, hey, we'll give you a gun if you give us a $20 gift card or whatever. If in any way the roles were reversed, you know that the public outcry would be just insane.
Oh, it would be called a buyback loophole?
Yeah. So anyway, the investigation's open. I don't know what's going to come of it. Yeah, it'd be cool if somebody did, because you know what? If we're going to get smacked down for stupidity and little piddling idiocies of the law, then damn it, they should too. It's ridiculous.
Well, according to the ATF, they should be investigated as a firearms dealer at this point.
Yeah, they should.
Because they've engaged in that number of transactions. They've engaged in effectively gunsmithing. So
right. Altering the firearm for factory condition.
I want to see their O2, their O7. What licenses do they carry as a group there?
As manufacturers, yeah. All right, brief intermission. So I'm a follower of Forgotten Weapons. Ian's great. I love his stuff. I wish we could get him on the podcast. Every once in a while I'll send him like emails and say, hey man, come on. He recently did a video and a post about the Spetsnaz Makarov holster. Okay. I have heard of these things before. They've been around forever. Folks, look it up. This is like just a perfect example of something you should not buy because while it may sound like a good idea on paper, in practice, it's just terrible. So it's an outside the waistband holster, right? It's an open carry holster. And the way that it's designed is designed specifically for the Makarov and the way that they're, you know, the way that they're oriented and set up. Pistol goes in this holster, and instead of your traditional draw where you grip and pull up
or away from the holster. Away,
right. The Spetsnaz Makarov holster is designed to push. And the idea is you put your hand on the butt of your gun and you push straight down along your thigh, and the holster grips the slide, racks the slide, right? So it immediately racks around into the chamber, and it also disengages the safety, all in one nice motion. Ideally, you push straight down, and you've got a gun that's been racked and loaded and the safety taken off. In practical reality, though... Just try to.
There's a couple flaws in that plan.
Yeah, right. It's perfect.
You can look back and say that this was a product of, you know, a bygone era, but there are very similar holsters that are still in design and that I see advertised.
That are meant to do kind of the same thing.
The magnetic. Yes. The magnetic under the desk and under the car dash mounts,
yeah,
where you grip the gun and push the gun forward, essentially like through the mount.
Yeah.
The friction from the mount racks the slide and has the gun ready to go. Tremendously
horrible.
Not a great idea.
Horrible. Just terrible idea.
certainly would not recommend this. First of all, open carry.
Right.
It's an open carry holster with no positive means of retention.
Right. Yeah. It's the opposite of positive retention.
As easy as it is for you to access and get that gun in a ready position, it's going to be easy for someone else to do it, maybe someone that you don't want to do.
Oh, what a terrible idea. It's just negligent discharge just waiting to happen.
Realistically, when you're going for the draw stroke and you're going for, you know, speed, your heart rate's up, maybe a little, you know, adrenaline's going. As you slam that hand into the holster to get a good grip on it, your timing better be spot on, because I see you just as easily shoving it right out of the bottom of the holster onto the floor.
The only practical, like, use for this holster is if you're carrying somewhere that requires you to carry empty chamber with a safety engaged. Like that's the only,
even then, but
it's a Makarov. It's got a double action trigger. It's, you know, it's perfectly safe on its own. It just doesn't need this. There's no reason to carry it empty chamber unless there's some law or something. But anyway, it's always good to get a chuckle out of Forgotten Weapons. They get some good stuff over there. Speaking of chuckles,
let's call it Capen v. Campbell.
Capen and National Association for Gun Rights v. Campbell.
Yeah. So looking at the National Association for Gun Rights, so they've had an ongoing legal battle against, you know, they filed a lawsuit in the state of Massachusetts a while back.
Yeah.
In response to the assault weapons ban, Healey, the whole deal. So they're challenging the assault weapons ban. They're challenging the ban on large capacity magazines. And their plaintiff is this guy, Capen. Mm-hmm. So right before the holiday, December 21st, U.S. District Chief Judge Frank Dennis Saylor IV denied the motion, National Association for Gun Rights motion for a preliminary injunction against the state's assault weapons ban. And to get that preliminary injunction, the plaintiffs, so NAGR and Capen, the judge has to agree that they have a likelihood to succeed on the merits of the case, that the plaintiff is likely to suffer irreparable harm in the absence of that relief. The balance of equities tips in favor of the plaintiff, and an injunction serves the public interest, which is a real sticky fourth one.
Those are all pretty subjective, really.
Well, we'll just, you know, spoiler alert, motion was denied.
Shocker.
As everyone knew it was going to be.
Shocker coming from a, you know, from somebody, from a judge here in Massachusetts. What a shock.
Yeah. Which is I think he was an appointed judge back from the George H.W. Bush administration, but don't quote me on that. I'd have to go back and dig up the guy's history. But what was written in his decision was just astounding. I mean, absolutely jaw-dropping. It's very obvious this person had a bias coming into this case.
We saw, like, back in, like, Catano, and we've seen over and over again how the judges here can, like, bend over backward to fit their prior positions. And this is just a crazy, another example of that.
Yep. So wrote in the decision, the court relies on the memoranda submitted by the parties and four essentially affidavits, written testimony submitted by support groups, whatever, outside entities that want to chime in on the case, essentially what they're talking about. Documentary evidence to decide the present motion. The four, I don't even know how to pronounce this as a plural.
Amici
curiae?
I think so.
I'll have Keith explain it one day. Yeah, right. But the four they relied on were from, drum roll please.
Yeah, right.
The Shocker. Brady Center to Prevent Gun Violence, March for Our Lives, Gifford Law Center to Prevent Gun Violence, and Everytown for Gun Safety. Those were the four outside bodies that they accepted briefs from. Yeah,
that they relied on. The court relies on those statements from those four people as completely unbiased. And
now the judge went through and wrote a bunch of stuff saying that the basic principle. So, you know, the first basic principle, individual self-defense, is a central component to the Second Amendment right.
That's right.
That was from Bruin, directly from Bruin. Mm-hmm. Also, the regulation of certain types of firearms, and in his decision, he writes weapons every single time. I'm going to replace them with firearms because I refuse to use their language.
Yeah,
weapon. It's a firearm. It's a weapon based on the intent of the user.
Yeah.
So, saying that regulations of certain types of firearms is permissible per the Heller decision, saying that some firearms might be regulated because they're not in common use, aka.
You mean typically, like AR-15?
Not typically possessed by law-abiding citizens for lawful purposes or self-defense. So, you know, the dangerous and unusual weapons. So imagine the entire Heller decision, and they only want to listen to one line of the entire thing. Also went on to say that, and really focused on this, that handguns are the, and I'm going to use the term weapon as part of the quote, but handguns are, quote, the quintessential self-defense weapon.
That's a quote.
Citing the Heller decision. Mm-hmm. So the judge made a bunch of arguments, and I want to get your kind of hot takes on this, Garrett.
All right.
So the plaintiffs claim that if a firearm is popular, thousand sold, million sold, then by definition, it would be considered in common use and sale and possession are protected and no further analysis of this whole debacle is required.
Of course.
Makes sense?
Makes sense.
The judge says, whatever meaning of common use you'd like to use, that contention cannot be correct.
Cannot be correct. Why not?
Cannot be.
Let's see.
So the judge argued. So the judge argued, and this is a judge's argument, that that rationale would actually create more problems than it would solve. Because, you know, like previously protected arms, you know, like flintlock muskets aren't that popular anymore and are relatively rare. So the judge was arguing is, would they lose protected status because they're no longer popular?
Is this guy a gymnast?
But then he said under that popularity approach that like a novel firearm that, you know, goes viral, to put it in today's terms, but something that gained like rapid popularity could be put beyond the reach of regulation if, as he put it, innovation and sales outpace legislation. And all you would need to do is flood the market prior to a governmental prohibition to ensure a constitutional protection.
Oh, they're saying the quiet part out loud there. They're like saying, you know, in effect, we should, you know, essentially ban everything that comes into existence. And it's no fair having people, you know, buy them up and establish common use.
Now, this is a line I think might even be useful for us from the Second Amendment side. But he said, you know, your analysis would be trapped in this kind of circular reasoning of a firearm could be banned because it's not in common use, and it's not in common use because it's banned. Like short-barreled shotguns are only rare because
they're banned on the internet.
It's an absolute headache and a nightmare to get one.
Yeah, right. You got to beg.
So the judge offered a couple approaches to considering common use. And according to the judge, per Heller and Bruin, it's to ask whether the firearm is the general type in common use by ordinary citizens for lawful purposes.
So if the answer is yes, then 2A presumptively applies. So how general can we get there? Do we say handguns are in common use, therefore none of them can be restricted or banned?
Well, so he said, well, you know, you can't ban the general category, but certain specific types may still be regulated if they're considered dangerous, unusual, and then that would be consistent with text, history, and tradition. So he's saying that, you know, you couldn't, and again, I might want to grab a couple quotes from this judge's decision, saying that you can't ban broad categories, handguns, rifles, shotguns. Hey, you know, the state of Massachusetts has tried that more than once, particularly what they're trying to do now, you know, with banning all semi-automatic firearms as a general blanket category. But subclasses and categories such as short-barreled shotguns, short-barreled rifles, that kind of stuff, therefore could be regulated.
What a novel approach. So as I say, both sides agree that the firearms at issue are presumptively protected by the Second Amendment, therefore the court does not need to resolve the meaning of, quote, in common use. The question becomes whether the regulation is consistent with the nation's historical tradition of firearm regulation, you know, as codified in Bruin.
So this judge says that all firearms, and this is from the judge's thing, all firearms by intention and design are dangerous. All are designed to kill or inflict serious injury. Accordingly, the term dangerous, to have any meaning at all, must be redefined in some way, or it will simply apply to every type of firearm, because all firearms are dangerous. All firearms are potentially useful for self-defense.
Wow. That's pretty circular. Jesus.
The guy says, well, you can't ban it because it's not common if it's not common because of the ban, but But he said, this is the example the judge gave. A private home bristling with machine guns at every corner, although may be considered well-defended, obviously poses a danger to others that does far beyond the reasonable requirements of self-defense.
Sounds like that house is pretty safe to me.
I mean, I know where I'm going when
people
are beating each other up over toilet paper in the parking lot.
Per Heller, the American people have considered the handgun to be the quintessential self-defense weapon. That's where that quote came from, right? If a handgun has features, it makes it more suitable for self-defense. It follows that other firearms may have features, including not only capabilities, but length, size, etc., that make them less suitable for that purpose. For a firearm to be subject to regulation, it must be unreasonably dangerous and unusual for ordinary citizens to use for lawful purposes, particularly self-defense.
Saying that assault weapons... Assault weapons didn't become popular with civilians until the present century.
That's not true.
Which I think you could almost, I mean, and I'm assuming I'll give the latitude that they mean the last 100 years and not just the 2000s.
Even still, it's factually not true, but yeah.
The term never existed prior to 1984.
Right, which
sure. Even though the AR has been in civilian circulation since the early mid-1960s, and that was only a result of Josh Sugarman and Handgun Control Inc. pushing that phrase forward, stating that their entire intent was to confuse people.
Yeah, I remember that. The menacing look. The firearm's menacing looks coupled with the public's confusion can only increase the chance of public support for restrictions on these firearms. Josh Sugarman, what a pile of nonsense that guy is.
So this is from the judge. It seems clear the features of modern assault weapons, using his term, particularly the AR-15's radical increase in muzzle velocity, range accuracy, and functionality, along with the types of injuries they can inflict, are so different from colonial firearms that the two are not reasonably comparable. Now,
Brown best, baby.
Sit a little back of the envelope calculation for those who want to know. The Brown best musket was a 75 caliber firearm, fired on average roughly about a 500 grain projectile, anywhere from 1300 to 1800 feet per second. The AR-15 firing the .223 Remington round at 55 grains at 3300 feet per second. The Brown Best musket on the lowest end of ballistic data was almost double the kinetic energy of a round from an AR-15.
It's more than an ounce of lead.
Because you can go back to Daniel Morgan's rifleman and his Morgan's shingle shooting test, where you had to shoot a slate roofing shingle at 250 yards.
Yep.
And then I managed to track down an article from the Virginia Gazette from September of 1775. And they said that a man held between his knees, which would make every RSO officer cringe and every other person cringe, but held a board 5 inches, a 5-inch by 7-inch board between his legs with a paper bullseye the size of a dollar, and that a rifleman at 60 yards freestanding, no rest, put 8 bullets in succession through that dollar bill.
I'd be unlikely to be able to see a dollar bill at 60 yards, much less hit it.
So this idea that we're just in this whole realm of impossible ballistics that nobody could fathom
is baloney. So let's see. He also said it imposes minimal burden on the right of self-defense because they're not reasonably suitable for self-defense under normal circumstances, nor are they normally used for that purpose. I mean, how do they make such a determination when gun control activists like the GVA colluded with CDC to scrub all of the defensive gun use data from the CDC website? Oh, Mark Bryant. Yeah, we talked about this one, too. The data needs to be killed, dug up, killed again, and buried again. The guy that runs the gun violence archive was talking about, you know, if it doesn't suit their narrative, it needs to be quashed, basically.
And CDC went along with it. Well, they resisted it. And then I think they got a little knock on the door from someone upstairs with a higher pay grade that said, you can absolutely remove that from the website.
Yep. Down it came.
And there were some other contentions saying that, you know, hey, the AR has greater range and muzzle velocity than a 9mm handgun, which is true. And that he used the term assault rifles were developed for modern military combat and not self-defense, which is misleading, I would say, but
misleading at best.
Also partly true if you stick to the actual definitions of what an assault rifle is. Also
goddamn irrelevant.
I wish people could see you on camera because I want to see your eyes roll to the absolute back of your head from this next line from this judge, where the judge said the AR-15 is functionally identical to its military counterparts, the M16 and the M4.
It's mil-spec,
which have the same basic structure, operation, near equivalent muscle velocities, and rates of effective fire. And he says rate of effective fire of 45 rounds per minute.
Oh, I don't even want to take that out. I take that apart. Oh. And then here we go with the shoot yourself in the foot argument, which is AR-15s are physically unsuited to typical self-defense scenarios due to being significantly heavier and longer than typical handguns, making them less concealable, more difficult to use, and less readily accessible, particularly for an inexperienced user. If you take
that, there isn't a firearms instructor in the state, not one, that I think would actually step up and make the argument that it is easier to teach someone to shoot a handgun proficiently
than it
as
is
opposed
a rifle.
To teaching them to shoot a glorified 22 rifle.
Yeah, it's a rifle.
Effectively.
And then you take that same rationalization and you copy it and paste it into another decision, and another judge will say, you know, exactly the opposite using the same rationale.
You know who they're not mentioning in any of this? The idiot that's doing something wrong that's going to warrant them getting shot.
Right. The bad guy never even comes into it, apparently. All of this stuff reads like he read a pamphlet of bullet points and then, like, didn't really understand any of them and just picked them. And, yeah, it's a list of bullet points. Oy. We also had something to say about large-capacity magazines.
Yeah, the big stuff is the assault weapons ban. But when it came to large capacity magazine regulations, which I think would be better suited as its own legal action, but according to the state's experts, aka gun control activists, essentially the closest analogy looking back into history for a magazine, according to them, is the cartridge box. And the cartridge box was always considered an accessory, not as an integral component of the firearm necessary for the firearm to function. So because it's, you know, as the old term, accoutrement, based on that evidence, that magazines would not fall within the founding definition of a bearable arm.
Therefore, they can be banned. Therefore, they're not but protected. Again, therefore, they can be
saying
banned.
Saying that, went back to the same logic of, you know, the broad category you can't ban, but the specifics you can. So he's saying that you can't ban all magazines as a general class because they are required for those firearms to function.
But it's unclear why the principle that some magazines be afforded constitutional protection requires the protection of all magazines. If there's a reason why that should be so, the plaintiffs have not supplied it. So he's arguing that you can't ban magazines as a class, but of course you can ban 11 round magazines.
The plaintiffs, NAGR's lawyers, try to give some historical analogs saying, well, the pepper box fired multiple shots. Yeah. The judge denied that as what the judge considered valid because he said, well, that wasn't magazine fed. That's just a bunch of barrels bundled together. So that's not the same thing. And then the plaintiffs claim that, well, you know, what about the Winchester repeating rifle? That by definition, for today's standards, could be considered a high capacity magazine because of how many rounds it holds.
Yeah.
They say, well, that doesn't count either because that's a manual action. So the judge is trying to conflate magazines with semi-autos, even though that there are magazine-fed bolt-action guns, lever-action guns, all sorts of stuff. But according to this judge, if there is a reason why an 11-round magazine rather than a 10-round magazine is reasonably necessary for the purpose of self-defense, it is not apparent from the record, according to this judge. Ordinary citizens undertaking lawful activities do not typically engage in extended firefights. To the contrary, the state has provided substantial evidence that in typical self-defense scenarios, a defender will only fire two or three shots. So the judge says, well, you know, if the average gunfight is two or three rounds, or the average self-defense scenario is two or three rounds,
then that's all you need. If you have more than that, then you must be intending to commit some crime.
Remember when they said Jim manipulated data for testimony? This is a gross manipulation of data because they took the defensive gun use data and statistics and they said, we're going to average all of them across the spectrum. So they included, like, in defensive gun use statistics, brandishing a firearm counts as a defensive gun use. Like, you pull the firearm out of the holster, you say, take one more step, and I'm going to fight back, and the person goes, all right, I'm out of here. That counts as defensive gun use with zero shots fired.
Yeah, right.
So if you have a defensive gun use with zero shots fired and a defensive gun use with eight shots fired, what does that average out to? Four. And they say, well, you don't need more than four.
Yeah.
It's like, well, the guy that needed 10 needed more than four, or the lady that needed 10 needed more than four.
So this guy, I mean, we dwell on this one because it's this is here, home in Massachusetts, right? This isn't some abstraction from out in the Midwest or something like that. This is
a Massachusetts case.
This is Massachusetts. This was National Association for Gun Rights coming in, basically filing a lawsuit against the Commonwealth's assault weapons ban, and this was where it currently sits. So this guy, Dennis Saylor IV, he's the chief U.S. judge of the United States District Court for the District of Massachusetts. You got to put all that crap on one business card. So this is U.S. District Court for Massachusetts. That's where this case was heard. That's where it was challenged. There is nothing. I mean, we go through the decision. We go through the findings. There is not a single word in there that's surprising to me. It's frustrating. It's Massachusetts. We know that the judges around here have no problem bending over backward in order to support an anti-gun position. There's nothing here that's surprising. You know, obviously there's more on this to be argued at higher levels. However, honestly, to read the initial complaint, I don't know. It reads to me like it was a little bit hurried and, you know, maybe it was kind of put together, you know, kind of quickly. We're going to move in, we're going to challenge this, and then we're going to move out. The problem is everybody knew how this case was going to work out, and now we're left holding precedent. You know, National Association of Gun Rights has gone back to wherever they've gone to. You know, they're doing their thing in other areas of the country. Meanwhile, this is precedent. This is a finding that we now have to deal with and live with. There's a lot to be said about filing these things strategically and with, you know, various people taking a look at it and narrowly focusing it. And, you know, that's, you have to be
careful. And collaborative efforts.
Yeah.
That's why you see, you know, GOA, FPC, and, you know, SAF working consistently with each other to say, all right, who's, you know, even understanding of, hey, what are you filing? If you're filing A, we don't need to file B. You know, perfect example of,
right. And instead of filing A in Massachusetts, we're going to file B in, you know, Idaho, where we might have, you know, more favor. It really sucks that it has to be done that way, but it does have to be done that way.
By the time you get to the Supreme Court level, you've spent $500,000 at a bare minimum, if not more.
Millions of dollars.
So if you already have something that is going the route of a Supreme Court case.
Yes.
You could almost make the argument that your money's better spent attacking a different issue to see how that one turns out first.
Right. How many assault weapons bans are being challenged right now across the country? You know,
many.
It ain't
half
one.
A dozen. Yeah, I think half a dozen.
Something like
major
that.
Lawsuits that could potentially go Supreme Court.
Yeah.
So what out are of the California, odds? Out of Maryland, out of Illinois.
So they're playing the odds that this is going to be the one that gains traction.
Yeah, I mean, I hope it wins.
Yeah, sure. I do too. Listen, I do too. You know, and I don't want to be like the doom crier over the whole thing. But these things have to be handled carefully.
If reading that judge's decision on the preliminary injunction doesn't bode well for how the rest of the case is going to go.
Right.
Yeah. At this point, reading this decision, this case is Supreme Court or bust, which means we're now stuck with this until 9 judges in Washington decide to hear a case and write something more definitive.
That's just it. These things have to be handled strategically and carefully. And you can't just say, you know, how many times did Jim come on here and say, you can't just throw a lawsuit at it. You know, it has to be done carefully or you're stuck holding bad precedent.
You really have to be careful and pick your battles.
Yeah. Yeah.
Very, very careful.
I really hope that this comes out in our favor, but I'm sure we'll be revisiting it again as the case moves along. Before we wrap up, I did have a mailbag question. I was, and I don't recall if we've done this one before. I don't think we have. I've been asked this question a couple times and I was like, all right, well, what the hell? Let's make a, you know, let's answer the question. So this one comes from a listener who I spoke to. He had a question regarding the apparent discrepancy between the prohibitions on the state level and the federal level, right? So we know that the disqualifier for an LTC and gun possession here in Massachusetts, we tell everybody in classes, right, if you have a felony conviction or a misdemeanor conviction that's punishable by more than 2 years in jail, right? So no matter what the actual sentence is, if you could have been punished by more than 2 years in jail, you're a prohibited person in Massachusetts. Mm-hmm. Right.
So you're talking statutory disqualifiers and typically the part of the law where you see, you know, crime X is punishable by up to X amount of years incarceration.
Right. So the big one that we bring up that's a misdemeanor is first offense OUI post 1994. Right. So a first offense OUI convictions. Now, we're not talking about continuation of fining or diversion trigger or anything like that. We're talking about convictions here. First offense OUIs in Massachusetts are typically misdemeanors, right? But the possibility of punishment for that misdemeanor is 2.5 years. Therefore, they can be disqualified, whether or not you actually get sentenced to 2.5 years or not, just because it's punishable by that much.
So, and that's one of the reasons why we say always talk to a firearms attorney, because you know, even if you, they say, hey, listen, you just plead guilty to it. We take your keys for 30 days. You do driver retraining class. You're back, like, you're good to go. Pleading guilty to that is your conviction. You're now disqualified for life. And your run-of-the-mill attorney might not know that.
Right. Grandpa's probate attorney is not gonna have all these details. So the relevant law here, if anybody wants to go look in, it's Mass General Law Chapter 140, Section 129B. Paragraph 1, I think. It says a prohibited person shall be a person who has ever in a court of law been convicted, whatever, you know, so on and so forth, for the commission of A, a felony, or B, a misdemeanor punishable by imprisonment for more than 2 years. That's the relevant statute, right? And it's got another thing, violent crimes, drug convictions, et cetera, all those other things. But that one sentence is what defines that 2.5, that 2-year prohibition thing. So knowing that, this person asked me, it's like, well, when I go buy a gun and I fill out a 4473, question 21D asks me if I've ever been convicted of either a felony or any other crime for which the judge could have sentenced you for more than 1 year. Is it 2 years for Massachusetts and prohibited, or is it 1 year federally? You know, why does 2 years in Massachusetts matter if 1 year federally is the cutoff? So that's the question, right? It's an apparent discrepancy there.
Well, to make sense of Massachusetts gun law is a pretty futile exercise. So there's a real possibility of telling people, it's like, it doesn't make sense. Well, it's not going to make sense. And, you know.
Well, there is actually an answer to this, and it lies in the previous chapter. So on the 4473, you will be denied if you say yes to question 21D, right? Have you ever been convicted of a crime punishable by more than 1 year? The relevant statute in U.S. law, in federal law, okay, is the Gun Control Act of 1968. Check out 18 U.S.C. 922G. Okay, and it says it shall be unlawful for yada, 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 who has been convicted in any court of a crime punishable by imprisonment for more than, for a term exceeding more than 1 year, you know, et cetera, right? So that's where that comes from. But it's not really a discrepancy. If you take a look at 18 U.S.C. 921A20, you have to look at the definitions, okay? Under that section, it says the term, quote, crime punishable by imprisonment for a term exceeding 1 year does not include any state offense classified by the laws of the state as a misdemeanor and punishable by a term of imprisonment of 2 years or less. That's where it comes together. So if you answer 21D, yes, you'll get disqualified. But if you're, you know, whatever it is that you're convicted of follows the definition outlined in section B of, you know, 18 U.S.C. 921, meaning the state offense classifies it as a misdemeanor and it has 2 years or less for potential punishment, then you can answer no to that question. Does that make sense?
Yeah. Now, I would clarify that if you find yourself in this sort of situation where you're not 100% confident one way or the other. We've said on the show multiple times over and over and over again, we're not lawyers. This isn't legal advice.
Absolutely.
And if you go into court saying that you heard this on a podcast, your butt's going to jail.
That's right. You're going to jail. So, don't take the word of some random podcaster that you listen to. find a lawyer, get them to answer it for real. But the bottom line here is that there's not actually a discrepancy there. It just sounds like a discrepancy.
Yep. Contact Goal. We will put you in touch with a good firearms attorney. I mean, that's part of what Goal is here for our members,
yeah,
is to help locate those resources for you. So if you say, hey, you know, I'm not sure how this plays out and how the law changed or yada, yada, yada.
Yep.
That's call us, call Goal. Let's get you in touch with the right people. Let's get you some proper legal advice.
Yeah.
And, you know, one that you can actually, plead your case with.
Take it to the bank. So that's that question. I mean, it's a legal question, so naturally it's going to be confusing, but it's not actually a discrepancy.
If something makes sense or sounds like fun, it's probably illegal.
There you go. All right. So you got a drill of the month.
So we wrapped up last year on training, did a lot, shot a lot, and then obviously got into hunting season. So there wasn't a lot of training in the second half of the year. Excuse me, I got a hiccup.
It's training of a second, of another sort.
Yeah, so the hunting season was really the employment of a series of training. And I would have to go out on a limb and say, you know, one of the advantages of having the background and training and experience of firearms is that, you know, when it comes to the hunting side of things, you know, taking the shot is it's a lot easier when you are confident in your marksmanship skills.
Yeah.
But
hence training.
We're going to do some drill of the month this year. Working currently on adding a video component. So for the folks that really need like a visual to understand what we're going for.
Yep.
That's in progress. Hopefully we'll have it out soon. The issue I'm running into is I'm essentially trying to do a decent job video editing on a Microsoft Surface tablet that doesn't have a lot of horsepower. So
that's challenging all by itself.
We're doing our best. Remember, it's a volunteer organization. I have a full-time job. I'm in Portland, Maine all week. So
bear with
patience
us.
Is graciously accepted. Right. But we're going to start off January 2024. We're going to do the hackathon warm-up drill. We've done this one before. It takes a total of 10 rounds on a standard IDPA target. You know, that big boxy looking one with the down zero and down one and down three. Very simple course of fire. So 3, 6, and 9 yards. So starting from the 3 yard line, it's, you know, you can use a shot timer. It's not timed or anything, but, you know, just on the go, you draw from concealment, you're firing one round to the head box of that IDPA target, 3 yards, and needs to be in that down zero, inside that down zero ring. Next stage, you're going to back up to 6 yards. Again, on that beep, draw from concealment. You're firing 3 rounds to the center mass of your IDPA target in that down zero circle. Third and fourth stages are both shot at 9 yards. On the beep, you're drawing from concealment, firing 3 rounds into that center down zero circle. You're doing that twice. So the third and fourth stage, you're just doing the same thing, just a little bit of repetition. The goal of the drill is not speed. The goal of the drill is accuracy. The rounds have to count. You cannot miss fast enough to win a gunfight, particularly in a self-defense situation. Now, it is true that you can shoot slow enough to lose a gunfight, but
that's the analog.
We need
the
to build on effective targets. Now, if you want a little bit of a challenge, you want to push yourself a little bit with this drill, repeat it a little bit, what you can do is reduce the target size area. So in the hackathons drill that he does specifically, he'll take like a roll of tape and draw like a 4 or 5 inch circle for that center chest area to represent something like the size of a heart box. And I think it's the way he put it, you know, a circle about the size of the rim of a coffee mug is a pretty good challenge.
Yeah.
So feel free to, you know, reduce your target size, set par times. You want to push the distance back to 10 yards, whatever. The idea of the drill is to get things moving, get the blood going, get warmed up, and get your mind in that space for a solid training day at the range.
There you go. First drill of the month for 2024. So we'll come back at the beginning of February and hear results, and we'll talk about going forward. Cool. That is actually going to wrap it up for today. Thanks for listening in. Be sure to subscribe to the Goal Podcast and check us out on Facebook at facebook.com/GoalPodcastMA, on YouTube at The Goal Podcast, or on Twitter at Goal Update.
To join Goal, visit goal.org and click the Join Renew button on the top of the homepage.
If you have a topic you think we should cover, if there's something going on in your club or your town, or if you have a question for the mailbag, shoot us an email at goalpodcast@goal.org.
The Goal Podcast is a production of Gun Owners Action League of Massachusetts. The views and opinions expressed are those of the hosts and guests and do not necessarily reflect those of Goal, its staff, or affiliates.